court's in session now. Here come the judge. Here come the judge.
Here come the judge. Here come the judge.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. The topic in these two videos about Ronald Dworkin is going to be interpreting the Democratic Constitution. So one of the things we'll see is that Dworkin isn't involved in the ordinary debates that we have over the Constitution in our political culture, like the debate over originalism or strict constructionism or another way of interpreting the Constitution. Even though he does mention these debates, and even though he takes a brief stand on the issues covered in these debates in order to sort of differentiate his view from others within the legal world, his real question is this: if we care about democracy, ought we to commit decisions about the meaning of the Constitution to judges or to democratic legislatures? Now, we're going to see later in our second set of videos for this class that Jeremy Waldron and others think that it's inconsistent with democracy to allow judges to overrule legislatures when it comes to questions of rights. But Dworkin wants to argue that the two can be meshed together in a certain sense. So this is an important key point that we'll see about Dworkin. He thinks that rights and democratic equality come from the same source within the liberal tradition. So think back to Locke. He said, we're equally born with the capacity that he called reason to make moral decisions. And so he said, because of that, we're not born subject to any kings or lords. We are born free and, he says, vested with equal decision-making powers at the very same time. So because rights and democratic equality come from the same source, Dworkin believes that using rights to sometimes trump the democratic decisions of legislatures doesn't contradict overall liberal values. Paradoxically, overriding the legislature can actually help us to achieve our vision of democratic egalitarian rights, he's saying. Okay, we're gonna look at that argument in great detail in our second video about Dworkin. Right now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna start with his arguments against originalism or strict constructionism and for what he calls the moral reading of the Constitution. And mainly, we're actually gonna start with his arguments against in order to show that these are not really his main concerns. It's not his main concern in his books to argue against originalism. Most philosophers, like Dworkin, don't take originalism very seriously. This is not to say in any way that there are no good arguments for originalism. It's just to say that they're not generally philosophical arguments. Why not? Well, let's put some definitions to terms. Originalism we could define as the idea that the Constitution has an original meaning, which was the intention of the framers, and that in accepting the Constitution as the guiding document for our politics, we become obliged to accept the framers' intentions as authoritative for us. So intent and obligation are key concepts for originalism. For instance, consider what some, not all, but some originalists have said about Brown versus Board of Education. They say that the 14th Amendment to the Constitution was passed by a Congress that at the very same time allowed and in fact even mandated segregated schools in DC. So they say it could not have been the intention of the 14th Amendment to outlaw segregated schools. We have to throw out Brown versus Board of Education. Now, the reason that political philosophers don't take much of this debate seriously isn't because they don't like a substantive conclusion like that. It's because of the philosophical uses of the terms intent and obligation. And I can sum this all up for you in one example that I'm going to call the deathbed promise. It's not an example from Dworkin's reading. It's one that another author called Christopher Eisgruber has used, but it'll illustrate really well for you a point that Dworkin is in fact making. Okay, so here's the example. Imagine that your overweight grandfather is dying of heart failure, and he says to you, promise me that you'll eat healthy. Now, the broad principle here is eat healthy. But over time, we know that that's meant different things. Meat and potatoes would have been the definition of it in the 50s, perhaps pasta, carbohydrates, and low-fat food in the 70s. good fats from fish and olive oil in the 80s. Then in the 90s, people started doing the Atkins diet. In the early 2000s, folks were saying, drink a glass of red wine every day. Now they're doing keto and Whole 30 and et cetera. Your grandfather had a general intent, but you would have changed what you did over the course of the decades. He had a general intent, but you had changing obligations. Notice those same concepts as are used in originalism. Your grandfather's intent was that you should eat in such a way that you don't end up like him. But he couldn't have meant any more than that you eat according to your best understandings of what would be healthy and what would help you to avoid heart disease. Now, he thought that if he had just avoided all those desserts and eaten meat and potatoes, he would have actually ended up healthy. But that doesn't mean that you have to feel yourself obliged to keep eating meat and potatoes in order to carry out his intent. His intent was really to make you promise to follow a general principle and to use your best judgment to carry it out in your context. So philosophers, by and large, reject originalism. The philosophers sort of turn the originalists' own arguments against them. Intent can never be anything more than general, and therefore our obligations can change over the course of time. Now, for sure, there are other benefits to originalism. Tradition may be something which has an independent moral force for us. Tradition may have a hold on our sentiments, and that means something. But you're very rarely going to find philosophers throwing their lot in with traditions, precisely because traditions hold their sway over us by sentiments and not by reasons. Now, also, there are folks who say that following the original intent of the framers plays another role. It helps to bring about political stability, sort of cementing in place bargains that were made with respect to trade or religion or whatever the case may be. But if that's the case, then originalism is really just a shorthand for something else. It's not a philosophy per se. It's just a unique and useful political arrangement. Now, political theorists, that is, the folks that you would find in political science departments, may take that argument for originalism very seriously, more seriously than philosophers do, since theorists do indeed try to see the way that political ideas are used and how political ideas might play institutional roles. So political theorists may be more willing to say that however much originalists try to give philosophical justifications for their ideas or however much they try to evoke traditions, the real use or function of originalism, a political theorist might say, is that it helps to ensure stability over the course of time. But again, that's not using the originalist's own arguments, that's substituting in another one. And you might also find, if you go to law school, that legal scholars take originalism seriously. It's their debate, after all. They get paid to carry it out in their research and in their writing. They get paid to teach it to their students. And indeed, they often teach their students how to do what's called law office history, which is these sort of short excursions into historical facts in order to justify a particular originalist reading of the Constitution, readings that real historians look at sometimes and scratch their heads. However, here's the interesting thing. Although Dworkin is both a legal scholar and a political theorist, two groups that take originalism seriously, his heart is really that of a philosopher. So he rejects originalism almost out of hand. For instance, in the reading called The Moral Reading on page 7, he says this: many of the clauses of the Constitution's Bill of Rights are drafted in exceedingly abstract moral language. The First Amendment refers to the right of free speech, for example, the Fifth Amendment to the process that is due to citizens, and the 14th to protection that is equal. These clauses refer to abstract moral principles and incorporate these by reference as limits on government's power. Now, passages like this can make it seem that Dworkin is engaged in something similar to the political debates about the Constitution, which are fairly common, but like I've said, he's not. Indeed, this is why he says that conservative politicians are often disappointed by the originalist justices that they choose. He says, well, there's really no tenable philosophical position called originalism, and so therefore, no judge can ever really stick to it. There's nothing to follow, or as a famous author once said about Los Angeles, there's no there there. Now, he's not trying to take a jab at conservative politicians here, not trying to take a jab at George H.W. Bush for his pick of Souter, not trying to take a jab at George W. Bush for his pick of Roberts. He's trying to say that the whole debate over this is ephemeral. originalism really provides no guidance about how to interpret the Constitution in specific cases. So even justices who endorse it, who say in their hearings that they endorse it, eventually need to actually turn elsewhere for principles to guide them in specific cases. And here's the thing, Dworkin is fine with that. He just thinks that they should admit it. Indeed, Dworkin endorses what he calls the moral reading of the Constitution. In the article called The Moral Reading on page 2, he says that this brings morality into the heart of constitutional law. Now, he says judges who are using the moral reading of the Constitution are not free to use their own morality to read their own morality into the Constitution. They are not free, he says, to make it mean whatever they want it to mean. Instead, he says, they have to follow a few steps. First, they try to understand the intentions of the framers in terms of the broad and vague principles that the framers intended to make obligatory. But then, knowing what they know about intent and obligations from our earlier examples, they try to understand all of the perhaps changing precedents of the court in order to understand how to interpret those principles. And then, because perhaps they face a brand new case, a situation that no court has ever faced before, they use their best understanding of the principles within the American legal tradition in order to decide this very new case. And this is what Dworkin means on moral reading, page 10, when he says, "Constitutional interpretation must begin in what the framers said. Judges may not read their own convictions into the Constitution. They may not read the abstract moral clauses as expressing any particular moral judgment unless they find it consistent in principle with the structural design of the Constitution as a whole and also with the dominant line of past constitutional interpretation by other judges." Of course, this doesn't mean that a court using the moral reading wouldn't sometimes issue highly controversial decisions based on seemingly entirely new principles. Because even looking back at the framers' intents and at the precedents that previous courts had ruled upon, judges may end up disagreeing about how best to interpret those and how to apply them to this very new situation. So Dworkin says in the moral reading on page 11, "Very different, even contrary conceptions of a constitutional principle, of what treating men and women as equals really means, for example, will often fit language, precedent, and practice well enough to pass these tests. And thoughtful judges must then decide on their own which conception does most credit to the nation." So you'll see here that Dworkin has offered justices a somewhat clear three-step process, which nevertheless results in a somewhat vague standard. But Dworkin says that this doesn't give the justices carte blanche to do whatever they want. While they use their best judgment, just as in that eat healthy example from earlier, judges aren't free to make the Constitution mean whatever they want it to mean. In this much, at least, Dworkin is really consistent with that stability argument that we considered earlier. Decisions will and must be rooted in what the framers said. And when there's some question about what they would have intended for us to do, judges then, and only then, can turn to their best understanding of what the whole national tradition, not their own morality, but the whole national tradition requires. So there are two anchors, really, holding understandings in place: the intent of the framers and the long history of precedents and tradition that have led us to our day. Now, a lot of objections have arisen to Dworkin's views. The most prominent of these we'll call the tyranny of the minority objection. And the objection is basically this, that it's undemocratic in some sense to commit these kind of open-ended decisions on principles to judges rather than to legislatures. But Dworkin says, no, that's mistaken. He says on moral reading pages 6 to 7 that people who regard the quote moral reading as elitist, anti-populist, anti-Republican, and anti-democratic, he says, rely on a popular but unexamined assumption about the connection between democracy and majority will, an assumption that American history has in fact consistently rejected. When we understand democracy better, we see that the moral reading of a political constitution is not anti-democratic, but on the contrary, is practically indispensable to democracy. So as I said at the beginning of these videos, the real question that Dworkin is addressing is not whether the Constitution is a document made up of moral principles. He thinks, using the philosopher's arguments against originalism, that it is, by definition. His real question is this, as I said before. If we care about democracy, ought we to commit decisions on the abstract moral principles of the Constitution to judges or to legislatures? And his answer, we've already seen a preview, is that we don't need to fear committing these sorts of decisions to judges, judges using the moral reading, as he calls it. We don't need to fear that that's anti-democratic. And obviously, in order to argue that, he's going to have to give us a new interpretation of what democracy means within the American tradition in order to convince us of this. So our second video will ask the question, what is his argument about democracy? What is his argument that he thinks can convince us that an unelected elite of judges is in fact a democratic body? Dworkin wants to sort of combine arguments for liberty and democracy together to show that the one flows from the other and that what joins them together is equality. So Dworkin argues that the Constitution and our traditions are best understood as being based on principles that he calls principles of equal concern and equal respect. So the argument from this he makes in the article called What Rights Do We Have? It's a difficult argument. I'm going to lecture about it in our next video. But in order to help you along with that argument, I've prepared a handout about it and put that handout on classes. So go get that handout now. Come back for our second video about Dworkin, and I'll talk to you about his quite unique argument about democracy. I'll see you then.